Good morning and welcome to First Wesleyan Church. We're glad you're here. Please stand with us. We're going to begin our service with singing.
You may be seated. Well, good morning and welcome to First Wesleyan Church. Thanks for joining us for today's service. I have a few announcements I'd like to mention of, but before I get into that, there is an attendance record sheet in one of the chair racks in front of you. If you attend here, please fill out this information, and on your way out of the sanctuary today, place it in the offering plate. If you're a first-time guest, first of all, welcome. We're glad you're here. If you wouldn't mind filling out this information, holding on to it, and in between the two double doors, there is an information desk, and we have a gift waiting for you. And just to say, thanks for being here. If you're attending online, please text 605-430-5673, and thanks for watching this morning. There will be a young adult study tonight at 6 p.m. at 3830 Wisconsin Avenue. If you are a young adult that wants to have some food, some fellowship, and some discussions about faith, please plan on attending this meeting. Also, if you have any questions, please see Pastor Steve. There is a women's event happening Saturday, September 16th, that's this coming Saturday, that's called Chat, Chew, and Comedy. The ladies have been handing out these postcards, and yes, this is a ladies' event, so only ladies are invited to this, but that is an okay thing. If you wouldn't mind, if you plan on attending this event, there is a sign-up sheet at the table up there with the telephone and everything, and that would be very helpful so they can plan on who is coming. On September 30th, there is going to be an outreach event happening at Edgewood Assisted Living here in town. We have the opportunity to go and help those individuals there by reading to them, either by playing games with them, having just conversations, whatever they need us to do. And this is, yes, an opportunity to serve our community, but it's also an opportunity to share our faith, to share the gospel with. So if you're interested in coming to this event on September 30th at 2 p.m., please sign up at the information desk that allows us to know who's expected on coming. For all other announcements, please look to your worship bulletin. But would you please stand and rise as we get to continue to worship Jesus, our Savior.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise, things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us, Jesus. A voice that calms a storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he fled as a lamb, he carries my healing. I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, I see a new revival stirring as we pray and sing.
the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes to the justice and mercy embrace. There the Son of God gave his life for us, and our measureless debt was erased. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes to the morning and see Christ the Lion away. What a glory Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes to the heavens. Our King will return for his own. Every knee will bow, every tongue will shout, all glory to Jesus alone. Our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
We want to go to the Lord in prayer today. We continue to go through the Psalms, and please hear the psalmist in Psalm 141 and how I'll be focusing my prayer time this morning. Verse 3. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. We talk about our language today during our prayer time. Would you bow your heads and would you close your eyes as we go to the Lord? Please know that the altar is open. If you'd like to come and you'd like to kneel, the altar is open for you. And I will pause a couple of moments if that's you. Gracious God, we're thankful for the ability to come into this place called a church. We know that it is much more than just a church building. It's a gathering of people, a body of believers, and we're thankful for that. We're thankful that you have established the church as a place to come, to receive instruction, fellowship, guidance, and encouragement. Thank you for the songs that we've been able to sing already today, talking of you, and turning our eyes to you. And now, God, I turn my lips to you as I pray this prayer. God, thank you for language in which we're able to communicate. If I got up here and spoke another language right now, you'd understand, Lord, but nobody else, most everybody else wouldn't. But you've given us lips to communicate and ears to hear. Thank you that we can praise your name from our mouths. Thank you that we can provide encouragement to others. Thank you that we can call you El Shaddai and Jehovah Jireh, Elohim, Almighty God. I pray that each time we say that name, God, that it wouldn't be in jest, but it would be in one of reverent worship of you, O God. Thank you for the power of Jesus' name, and how when we say that name, there's power in his name, and we're sure thankful for Jesus being in our lives. We're thankful for the Holy Spirit who comforts us and ministers to the depths of our being. God, today I ask that you would help us, that you would put a guard over my mouth and everybody else's lips that are here. Keep a watch over the door of our lips. Please forgive us when we say things that are not pleasing to you, and may we be ones that utter praise to you. James says, out of the same mouth receive blessing and cursing. My brethren, this ought not to be. Help us to be ones that share praising and not cursing. Matthew is the one who says, out of the overflow of the heart does the mouth speak. And I just pray that you would help our mouths to utter godly things, that our hearts would be righteous and good and clean, and out of them would come encouragement. And so, God, we give you praise today with our mouths, and we say we love you and we're thankful for you. God, I pray that as we think through our last week, if we've said anything with our lips that have been demeaning, boastful, discouraging, that we would repent of that and say, God, that wasn't the right, I shouldn't have said that. And I'm thankful, God, that you're willing to forgive us, and may our words be one of praise unto you. God, we're mindful to think of our missionaries. Thank you for Randall and Linda Freeman. And I pray that as they finish up and retire, that you would encourage them, give them the next step in their journey, and may they just know ever so clear what you are calling them to do. I pray that you would raise up another missionary wellness coach that can fulfill this role, and thank you for their years of influencing the missionaries and encouraging them. God, I pray that you would be with our sister church here in town, Fountain Springs. Thank you for Pastor Dave Canan, his wife Katie, and the staff that is there at the West Campus, the East Campus. Thank you for the great outreach they have into our community. And I pray that you would bless them with salvation, with discipleship, and with continuation of what you've called them to. God, we pray for our president today. We're thankful for Joe Biden and his wife Jill, and I pray that as he goes about a number of things that he does, I pray that he'd make good and godly decisions. And I pray that you would set a guard, O Lord, over his mouth as well, and that he would utter truthful things, things that are righteous and good. God, I pray that you would be with our military. I'm so thankful for them. And in coming days, it seems like we're going to have a bomber coming here on the east side of town. Thank you for that. And I pray that you would just help in all the plans that are already being made for that. And as people come into this area, may they sense your presence here and worship you as Almighty God. God, I'm mindful to think of several, some of those by name. Thank you that Joni Nelson made it back. And thank you that Jesse's here with us in the service today. Be with Shirley Edwards, those who have had surgery. I pray that you would be with someone else here today or maybe viewing online that is dealing with some physical infirmity. I pray, God, that you would be Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals, and that you would touch them. And so, God, thank you for your healing touch that you provide. I ask, God, that you would continue to be with us as we open your word, that you would speak, and that we would hear you ever so clearly. Thank you for your power and your might. And thank you that we can proclaim your name. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. If you have your Bibles today, I encourage you to open them to Deuteronomy chapter 29. If you didn't happen to bring a Bible, there's one in a chair rack near you, and it's on page 171. The title of the message today is Don't Abandon the Covenant. Now, it's one of those, man, is this what's he going to talk about? I'm going to talk about the covenant that God had with the Israelites and the covenant that he has with us. And I hope that there's just something within you. It's like, wow, God does this for me. This is incredible because he wants a covenant with you. There's a reason that God sent his son Jesus to die for each of us. And this message is going to talk about the covenant that God was making with the Israelites. And then I want to point you to the covenant God makes with each of us. I hope that today you're blown away with the fact that the eternal God wants to have a covenant with each one of us. And please know that. It's not just a covenant with me because I'm a pastor. It's not a covenant with Pastor Mark or Pastor Bradley because they're pastors. It's a covenant with each one of us. You'll see it in the text that he talks about the covenant with us all. What's a covenant? I wonder if you've thought about covenant in recent days. It's not one of those words that we use. Oh, hey, you want to establish a covenant with me? I mean, we don't use covenant much. I don't even know of 2023 if you've ever used the word covenant. And so it's like, that's a biblical term. So what does covenant mean? What's another piece of language we could use? A covenant could be used in the light of an agreement. And that's what Bing.com, Wikipedia says, an official agreement or a compact. Maybe you would know of a covenant maybe that you have made. Several of you in this room made what they called a marriage covenant. Now, you didn't think it was a marriage covenant. You just thought, I'm just getting married to this lady, you know, and here we go. But it was a marriage covenant. It was before God and before others. Some of you have entered into a homeowner's covenant, and you didn't think it was that big of a deal until, well, you have to continue to pay for that homeowner's covenant, as well as, I can't paint my house pink? Well, no, you can't. You got to have a beige color because you're part of a covenant, and you have to do that. Maybe as a young boy or a young lady, I think it happens more with boys, you were blood brothers, and so you made a little covenant with somebody. Or there's debt covenants, there's property covenants. Maybe you've been... Oh, man, if you've ever been involved in a property covenant settling, oh, those are challenges. Have you ever had any of those law covenants, religious covenants? I wonder if you've ever made a deal with someone and it didn't turn out exactly like you thought. You saved your money, you were ready to purchase something, maybe like a car, and you bought a car, and then a week after you purchased the car, the transmission goes out. Now, isn't those fun days, you know, when you're like, oh, this is a great deal, and then, oh, there's another $5,000 that I get to pay. Or this house looked really good, and then it started to rain, and you're like, that water shouldn't be, that shouldn't be happening right there. And you thought everything was fine. Or maybe you dated a guy, and it was really nice, until. Or maybe you agreed to be in charge of something, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, I got to fill all these holes, and why am I the one that's all in charge? You maybe said yes to something, and the cost saving soon became more cost to you. These aren't covenants. Covenants are ones that we make before God, but maybe you feel this way in your relationship with God, that you're like, well, this covenant with God, it sure hasn't been all roses. Well, it's been a lot of thorns of the rose. It sure hasn't been a lot of petals. But I just want to remind you what Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33. Here's what he says. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. Catch that. You may have peace with God Almighty. But then he says this. In the world you will have tribulation. But take heart. I have overcome the world. He desires, God, the best for you and the best from you. And he helps us in those days because he actually helps us keep our part of the covenant. Why does God want a covenant with us? Because of his love. He created us in his image and he desires us in heaven. So what did God tell the Israelites about the covenant? And then how can we keep the covenant with him and the new covenant that is coming or has come to us? Deuteronomy chapter 29, I'm going to read a rather lengthy part here. I'm going to start at verse 10, and I'm going to go through verse 29. And again, if you want to follow, you can follow on the screen behind me, or there's a Bible in the chair rack near you. It's on page 171. Or maybe you brought your own Bible today, or maybe you bought an electronic gadget of some kind. But follow along in the scripture, however you want to follow along. You are standing today, all of you, before the Lord your God, the head of your tribes, your elders and your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones, your wives, and the sojourner who's in your camp, from the one who chops your wood to the one who draws your water, so that you may enter into the sworn covenant of the Lord your God, which the Lord your God is making with you today, that he may establish you today as his people, and that he may be your God, as he promised you and as he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. It is not with you alone that I'm making this sworn covenant, but with whoever is standing here with us today before the Lord our God, and whoever is not here with us today. You know how we lived in the land of Egypt and how we came through the midst of the nations through which you passed. And you have seen their detestable things, their idols of wood and stone, of silver and gold, which were among them. Beware, lest there be among you a man or a woman or clan or tribe whose heart is turning away today from the Lord our God to go and serve the gods of those nations. Beware, lest there be among you a root bearing poisonous and bitter fruit. One who, when he hears the words of the sworn covenant, blesses himself in his heart and says, I shall be safe, though I walk in the stubbornness of my heart. This will lead to the sweeping away of moist and dry alike. The Lord will not be willing to forgive him, but rather the anger of the Lord and his jealousy will smoke against that man, and the curses written in this book will settle upon him, and the Lord will blot out his name from under heaven. And the Lord will single him out from all the tribes of Israel for calamity in accordance with all the curses of the covenant written in this book of law. And the next generation, your children who rise up after you, and the foreigner who comes from a far land will say, when they see the affliction of that land and the sicknesses with which the Lord has made it sick, the whole land burned out with brimstone and salt, nothing sown and nothing growing, where no plant can sprout, an overthrow like that of Sodom and Gomorrah, Admah and Zeboim, which the Lord overthrew in his anger and wrath, all the nations will say, why has the Lord done this to this land? What caused the heat of this great anger? Then the people will say, it is because they abandoned the covenant of the Lord, the God of their fathers, which he made with them when he brought them out of the land of Egypt, and went and served other gods and worshiped them, gods whom they had not known and to whom he had not allotted to them. Therefore, the anger of the Lord was kindled against this land, bringing upon it all the curses written in this book, and the Lord uprooted them from their land in anger and fury and great wrath and cast them into another land as they are this day. The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but But the things that are revealed belong to us and our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. Here's the first point. God wants a covenant with everyone. I don't think you understand that, because I don't totally understand that. But let me just remind you, God wants a covenant with each one of us, every one of you. There's not a one, well, you don't, you not. Yes, God wants a covenant with you. He wanted a covenant with the Israelites. Do you see what it says there? Verse 10, you are standing today, all of you, before the Lord your God, heads of tribes, elders, little ones, wives. He wanted a covenant with them, not just a verbal or nice agreement. Let's just be friends. I had a friend I was able to hang out with here about a week or so ago. He was in town, and I chatted with him for 2 hours. I knew him in college, and it was neat. But we don't have a covenant relationship. We have a friendship. I mean, and that's fun. I stay in contact with him. I found online a firm called Up Counsel that had ideas between covenants and contracts. Here's what they say. A contract is invalid when one of the involved parties violates it. On the other hand, a covenant remains intact even if one of the parties breaches it. A covenant is a written promise between two or more parties. A covenant, it might be included in a contract. What are the differences? A contract is a legal binding document. A covenant is a spiritual agreement. A contract is an agreement you can break, and maybe you've had one of those before, either from your side or from somebody else. A covenant is a perpetual promise. A contract is a mutually beneficial relationship where a covenant is something you fulfill. I want you to hear these words again in verse 12 and verse 13 and how personal they are, so that you may enter into the sworn covenant of the Lord your God, which the Lord your God is making with you today, that he may establish you today as his people. That's a fun one, I think. That he may be your God. God wants to enter into this sworn covenant with each of us. And he was establishing that with the Israelites. Can you believe this? God of the universe wants a covenant with you and with me. I just think that's great. And if you don't agree with me, well, I just think that's wonderful. Included in this all is one of these words here in verse 11. It says, your little ones, your wives, and the sojourner. You knew who the sojourner was. It wasn't somebody, it was just somebody that came in. Some would say a stranger. Matthew Henry says that this all is included with the stranger in their midst. He says in this way, it's also an early indication of the favor to the Gentile and the kindness that God had for them. Now, what does that mean exactly? Who were the chosen people? It was the Jews. And it was the Jews, 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 Jews for the Old Testament. And then what happened in the New Testament when Jesus came and when Paul came? He's like, hey, not only the Jews can have, but guess what? The Gentiles can have this gospel. And he is saying, Matthew Henry, this is the early indication to say, you know what? The Gentiles, who we are able to have Christ as well. Now, some of us do an excellent job of this. There is no stranger in your midst. Some kids do this well. Some kids are like, stranger, danger, ah, and they're scared of everybody. But there are some kids that are just like, go to anybody, you know, and like, hey, what happened here? How did they get so comfortable with these individuals? But it was saying, no, you don't have to worry about the stranger. And some of you are very kind to those strangers around you, saying, come on, God wants you too. God wants all of us. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 11, Paul is talking here. And Paul says it like this. Let me get there here. He says it this way. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. He was saying all. He wants everyone to have a covenant with him. Not just priests, not just male, not just female. He wanted everyone, and it's still true. The second thing is this. The covenant was in the sight of God and others. You are standing today, all of you, before the Lord your God. We have public ceremonies for a number of things. We have graduations, and people go across the stage, and everybody applauds them. Some are like, oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. He made it. That's so good. Maybe that was you. Ooh, I made it. That's really good. We have retirements. We have inductions. We have birthday parties. Why? To celebrate, not just by ourselves, but with many. God wanted these people to see it wasn't just one person. It was before God. Wasn't standing before a king. Wasn't standing before anybody else. It was standing before God. Now, there are some covenants that we make that we stand before God. One of those is marriage. Several of you have entered into what they call a marriage covenant. Thank you. Hold true to your vows. I know the temptation and other things are there. Trials come, but you hold true to those. In the first service, we were able to dedicate Graham Frederick. He's a year old young man, and if you don't know Graham, he's just a little guy. And he actually didn't squawk when I held him, which was very nice of him to do. And the Fredericks, Scott and Brooke, are saying, we are going to raise this young man in the way of the Lord. Can Graham get to church by himself? No, he's 1 year old. He has a 3-year old sister, but I don't think that Haley and Graham should be wandering along Elkville trying to find the church. They say that she knows how to get to the church, or she can, you know, identify some of those things, but we don't let them. But they were standing before God saying, we're going to raise this child in the way of the Lord. When somebody is baptized, they're saying, I'm going to keep this covenant with the Lord. Maybe you've never been baptized before. If you've never been baptized, we'll have a baptism coming up here in October. Love to have you be baptized. We do this before a court, and we say, so help me God. The Israelites were standing before God, just like you and I stand before God and all people. In Psalm 105, the psalmist reminds us of this, verses 8 through 11. He remembers his covenant forever. The word that he commanded for 1,000 generations. That's a long time, by the way. The covenant that he made with Abraham, his sworn promise to Isaac, which he confirmed to Jacob as a statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as your portion for an inheritance. The covenant was in the sight of God and others. The third thing is this. Everyone must keep the covenant. God never broke the covenant with the Israelites, and God will never break his covenant with you. Let me repeat that. God never broke his covenant with the Israelites, and he'll never break his covenant with you. And one of the great things about it is that he helps us in our side of trying to keep the covenant. Kind of like when your wife helps you trying to keep your side of the deal that you said that you're going to keep, but you're not doing it very well. Or your husband helps you, however it might be. We break covenants. Sometimes we break contracts or warranties or insurances or treaties, but God does not. Let me stop and say this. I apologize to you for people who have broken a covenant or a contract or something with you. That hurt, and that wasn't fun. And God says, forgive them. But he also says, you hold up your end of the covenant, whatever you can do. This covenant was to be with those, I don't know if you saw it, with who were there and who were not there. It's kind of funny. Verse 15, but whoever is standing here with us today and with whoever is not here. Maybe they were out doing something else, or maybe they weren't even born yet. But he's saying, keep the covenant. But then he goes on to say, Moses, in verse 18, he says, beware lest there be among you a young man or a woman or a clan or a tribe whose heart is turning away today from God. Be careful with this. Don't be the person that turns away from God. You stay true whatever the cost. No matter what it comes, you stay true to the covenant. What would turn them away? Well, he tells them to serve the gods of those nations. He talks about idols of wood and stone, of silver and gold. Now, again, I assume that you don't have a lot of wood or silver or gold that you're worshiping. If you are, then stop it. Don't serve money. That's not going to take you anywhere. I mean, it's nice for a while. But serve God. He says, be careful that there's nobody turning you away. Sometimes there are some idols that are other things. Maybe you're a green and yellow or purple and gold or orange and blue fan. And there's an idol in our nation, maybe possibly, that today is a significant day for many. We have 70 and 80 and 60,000 people that are showing up to go to some kind of sporting event called football, what we call it. Just several days ago, there was an interesting event that happened in Lincoln, Nebraska. Was anybody there? There was in Memorial Stadium. There was 92,003 people in Memorial Stadium. That's their football stadium. But what they did was they decided to have an outdoor volleyball game, and they wanted to set a record how many were going to be at an event. And so, sure enough, there was 92,003 people at a women's sporting event, the most ever for a women's sporting event. Now, please hear me. I'm not down on women's sporting. I'm not down on volleyball. But isn't it interesting how where we gather for these events? I don't know if you notice this, but we have room yet in our sanctuary available for people to come. I'm assuming there's other churches in town today that aren't quite busting at the seams. There's an idol that happens in our culture of sports, and we have to be very careful as parents. If you're a parent, be ever so careful here, because coaches want, right now, Sundays, a number of days, sports can be an idol. Books can be an idol. Movies can be an idol. Selfishness. What are reasons to abandon the covenant? Why did they abandon the covenant? Because of idols, but because of this, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Now, that's in the New Testament. But also forgetfulness, ungratefulness, and pridefulness. Don't abandon the covenant because you forget what Christ did for you. And that's the major deal. In verse 18, again, it says, beware at the beginning. At the end part of the verse, it says, beware lest there be among you a root bearing poisonous and bitter fruit. In the King James Version, it says, bearing bitterness or wormwood. You ever heard the name wormwood at all? If you've ever read a book by C.S. Lewis called The Screwtape Letters, wormwood is mentioned in there. As well as if you've ever read the comics, do you know where wormwood is at? Anybody know wormwood? If you ever look in Calvin and Hobbes, if you're a Calvin and Hobbes fan, the teacher's name is Miss Wormwood. Wonder where they got that from, right there. Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 18. If you want to, after the service, don't do it now. You can look up a Calvin and Hobbes, and he's kind of funny. I don't want anybody to say of me, and I don't want anybody to say of any of you, what was said in verse 25. They abandoned the covenant of the Lord. Have you ever had somebody back out on a promise with you? Now, maybe it was just spending time with you or buying you a candy bar or asking for a favor, but when the person didn't do that, we're going to go on vacation, and you never did. Wow. When your parents promise you something, be very careful, parents, what you promise, because your kids remember that. Maybe you, as an adult now, remember a promise that your parents made that they never kept, and it might have been small or it might have been large, but you remember it. And so as parents, we have to be very careful. And we're saying, okay, I don't want to abandon this covenant. This covenant thing may not be a big deal to us, but it is a big deal to God. He sent his one and only son to establish a relationship with us, and he established a covenant with the Israelites, and he wanted them to keep their side of the bargain because of how special it was to him. When we accept Christ into our lives, we can view it as warm and fuzzy, or hell insurance, so I don't have to go to hell, or life transformation. But when we look at it deeper, a relationship with God is a covenant with him, and it's a big deal. It's just not small. He wants a relationship. He wants a covenant with you. In verses 18 and 26, it says that they went and served other gods and worshiped them, not just merely falling away, but serving something else. It's sometimes we just get idle time, but then when we take that idle time and we do something else with it, then that's another step to it, and I think that's the same as well. What can happen if they were to abandon? It was God's anger. Now, this is not the fun part of the text. If you want to go back to Deuteronomy chapter 27 and 28 and see the curses and be enlightened for the afternoon, then you can do that. But man, we want to keep the covenant with God. Do you need to be in a covenant relationship with someone? Do you need this as a reminder to hold up your end of a covenant relationship with someone? Maybe when they're not even holding it up on their half. It doesn't matter. God asks you to give of your best, 100%. And have you entered into a covenant relationship with Christ? Moses is telling us from God that the Israelites need to be careful that all follow the covenant. And we need to be that as well. And we need to keep the covenant individually and corporately. The fourth thing, the secret things and the revealed things. The secret things belong to the Lord. We can't know all. What is this covenant stuff about, really? Two things. God wanted the Israelites to know that this was a serious deal. He didn't want them just think this was, oh, I'm just not showing up for an appointment. Oh, bad. Too bad. No. He is saying this was real. This was binding. This was important. And it leads us to the next covenant. That is the covenant we have with Jesus when we receive him into our lives. He's wanting us to know that God sent his son to establish the new covenant with us. And that he expects and he believes and he hopes and he depends on us keeping our end of the deal. Now, he knows we're going to fall short, and so that's why he spent his Holy Spirit to guide us. Here is what Matthew Henry says about this. This requires us to be sincere and serious, humble and reverent in our covenant transactions with God, remembering how great a God he is, how great he is with whom we are covenanting, who has a perfect knowledge of us and an absolute dominion over us. Prophet Jeremiah, in Jeremiah 31, talks of the old covenant. He talks about the new covenant. Here's what he says. 31, verse 31. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with the fathers on their day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Hear me in this. When you become a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, keep that on the screen for a moment. When you become a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 33 of Jeremiah 31 says, he is going to put his law within your heart, and he is going to be your God, and you will be his people. And so that's why you have a desire to do what is right and good instead of doing evil and bad, because he puts that law into your heart. And that's why you should be in God's word, so his law can be in your heart and in my heart. But do you know who established the new covenant? It was Jesus. It's mentioned in Matthew chapter 26, Mark chapter 14, and in Luke 22. But it's mentioned by Paul as he's talking about the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25. Here's what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he's talking about the Lord's Supper. He's talking about communion when he had it with the disciples. Verse 24 says, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And in verse 25, "In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Jesus came and he established from the old covenant the new covenant with you. Each time we have communion, please just don't take it and say, "That's nice." Do it as a remembrance of Jesus coming to provide a new covenant with you, his follower. And as the covenant that he wants with you, he wants with everybody else. He doesn't want anybody else to have the covenant with you, not another God. But God made this covenant, an everlasting covenant through his son, Jesus. And God writes this covenant on our hearts. In Hebrews chapter 8, it actually quotes that Jeremiah passage pretty good. But then he says this at the end of Hebrews chapter 8, verses 11 through 13. "And they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, 'Know the Lord,' for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will be merciful towards their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more." Verse 13, "In speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. The enemy of our souls does not want us to have a covenant with Almighty God. But Almighty God says, 'I gave a covenant to the Israelites, and now I'm giving to you a new covenant.'" For the Israelites, it may have come through one person that they were torn away and was poisonous. In our lives, it comes through temptations. And God says, "Beware and keep the covenant." May you, may I, may we be reminded to keep this covenant with Almighty God. And may we be careful to keep this covenant with him. And let us show that we love God by keeping our part of this covenant. Would you stand with me today? I want to pray for each of you. Maybe for you. You've never entered into a covenant relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, as I pray, maybe you just want to say, "God, I want to be in that covenant relationship." Almighty God wants that with each of us. Maybe you've already entered into a covenant relationship, but you've been kind of haphazard about it. "Well, that's nice. I'm a Christian. I'm a believer." Let me remind you, God has a covenant relationship with you, and may we respond to that covenant relationship. Almighty God, I thank you that you established a covenant relationship with the Israelites so many years ago. Thank you for including all, the priests, the elders, the sojourner, the little ones, the wives. You didn't just include one, you include them all and said, "I want a covenant with everyone." You want a covenant with all of us. That's audaciously crazy. but you do. I know we're good, but we're not that good. So God, thank you for wanting a covenant with us. I pray that you would be with somebody here this morning who's never entered into a relationship, and they're not even sure what it means, a covenant relationship with you. It seems like a little too aggressive, but that's what you want. You want to shower them with your love. You want to live with inside of them. You want to write the law on the tablets of their hearts. Oh God, I pray that there just be one today that would say, "Yes, I want God, and I want to enter into a covenant relationship and establish and be a part." Oh God, would you be with that one? And then God, I pray that you would be with those many individuals who know you. May they know that this isn't just a game. This is something serious. But the seriousness of it is because you want a covenantal relationship with me. You want a covenantal relationship with each person here. Whatever man, whatever woman is here, you want a covenant relationship with them. And so, God, I pray that they would know of that and they would walk in that covenant. Rid the evil from our midst. Help us not to have any root-bearing, poisonous, and bitter fruit, but may we have your living word within us. And then, God, I pray that you would show us those secret things and that we would trust in you. God, I pray that you would go before each man and each woman, and each boy and each girl that's represented here in the sanctuary online today. I pray that they would be reminded of your covenantal relationship. And as they go out, there's a number of individuals that don't have a relationship with you, so they don't get it. And I pray that they would, through our talking to them. I pray that you would guide each heart, each mind, and each action of ours. And may our lips, as we speak this week, be glorifying unto your name. May you guard our mouths. Thank you, God, for your love. Go before us and give us of your strength, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen.